think of a little story. If I'm not taking too much of your time now, and it's preliminary, I do this for a purpose. I feel the Spirit just right to start. This is a sacred thing. Who knows them things there? Nobody but God. And they're not supposed to be revealed and proved in the Bible that they would not be revealed to this day.
Amen.
Exactly right. They was guessed at, but now we're supposed to get it exactly the truth, vindicated truth. Notice, now there was a little girl in the West that how she fell in love with a man and fell in love with her. As a buyer of the cattle come out there for the Armour Company, and they had the boss come one day, the boss's son from Chicago, and of course they put him on a regular Western frontier. The girls there, they dressed up, each one was going to get this boy, sure, you know, because that's a main man's boy. So they dressed in their Western frontier, and they do that out West. They just got through one of those episodes, and Brother McGuire, I think he's here now. They caught him downtown without his Western clothes on, and they threw him in the jail and put him in a kangaroo court and made him pay for it, and then made him go buy a Western outfit. I seen the rest of them walk around with guns about that long hanging on them. They just go native out there. They're trying to live in something in the back gone days, bygone. See? And then in Kentucky, you're trying to live in a bygone days of the East here, the back in Renfro Valley and things. You like to go back to the old days. There's something causing that. But when it comes back to go back to a gospel, in the original, you don't want to do that. You want something modern, see? Go show them. See, what makes a man do wrong, what makes him drink and carry on, or a woman do wrong, is because she's trying to, there's something in her thirsting, something in him thirsting, and they're trying to quench that holy thirst with the things of the world, when God ought to be that quench. He made you that way to thirst. That's the reason you thirst for something. God made you that way, so you turn that holy thirst to him.
Amen.
But when you try to quench that thirst, how dare anybody to do that? You have no right to do that. To try to quench that holy thirst that you thirst for something, and then you turn it into the world, try to satisfy it with the world, you can't do it. There's only one thing to fill that up, and that's God. And He made you that way. So this young girl's put on a regular Western carry-on for this boy when he come out, and each one of them is sure they're going to get this boy. There's a little cousin there on the ranch, and she was an orphan. And so she just done all the work for these, because they had to have the fingernails fixed, you know, and they couldn't wash the dishes for the hands and things, and she done all the real hard work. And then finally, when the boy came, they went out and got him in the old Western style, the buckboard, and they come in shooting their guns and carrying on, you know, and acting up. And that night they had a great big dance out there on an old-fashioned dance, and all the ranchers around about and coming in with their dancing and so forth. And first thing you know, this was jubilee for two or three days. Then one night, this boy stepped out of the place just to rest a while from the dance and got away from these girls, and he looked going down towards the crowd. There went a little girl, kind of ragged looking, and she had a dishpan full of water. She washed the dishes, and he thought, I never seen her before. I wonder where she come from. So he just puts in his way to go around the side of the bunkhouse, go down there and come back side of the corral, and met her. She was barefooted. She stopped. She held her head down. She seen who it was, and she was very shy. She knew this great person. And she was just a cousin to these other girls. Her father was foreman on this big Armour outfit. So they kept, she kept looking down. She's ashamed of being barefooted. He said, what's your name? She told him, said, why ain't you out there to where the rest of them is? She kind of made excuses. And so the next night he watched for her again. Finally, he's sitting out there, and they all got to carrying on everything. He sat on the corral fence and watched for her come throw the dishwater out. And he watched her, and he said to her, he said, "You know my real purpose of being here?" She said, "No, sir, I don't." He said, "My purpose of being here is hunting a wife." He said, "I find a character in you that they don't have." I was thinking of the church, you see. He said, "Will you marry me?" She said, "Me? Me? I can't think of such a thing. The me? Oh, see, that's the main boss's son. He owned all the companies and ranches throughout the country and everything, see?" Said, "Yes, said, I couldn't find one in Chicago. I want a real wife. I want a wife with character. And the thing that I'm looking for, I see it in you." Said, "Will you marry me?" She said, well, it startled her. And she said, "Yes." And he said, well, told her he'd be back. Said, "Now you just make yourself ready. In a year of the day, I'll be back. Well, and I'll get you, and I'll take you away from here. You won't have to work like this no more. I'll take you, and I'll go to Chicago. And I'll build you a home like you've never seen." She said, "I don't never had a home. I'm an orphan." He said, "I'll build you a home."
Hallelujah.
A real one. Said, "I'll be back." He kept in track with her during the time of the year. She worked everything that she could do to save enough money at her dollar a day or whatever she had with her board to buy her wedding dress. Perfect type of the church.
Hallelujah.
She got her garments ready. And you know when she displayed this wedding garment, her cousin said, "Why, you poor silly kid, you mean to think that a man like that have anything to do with you?" She said, "But he promised me." Amen. Said, "He's promised." Said, "I believe his word."
Amen.
"Oh, he's just making a fool out of you." Said, "If he'd have got somebody, he'd got one of them." Said, "But he promised me. I'm looking for it." Amen.
Hallelujah.
"I am too."
Hallelujah.
So kept getting later and later. The day finally arrived. Certain hour he has to be there. So she dressed in her garment. And she hadn't even heard from him. But she knew he'd be there. So she dressed up in her wedding clothes, got things ready. Well, then they really did laugh, because the main boss had sent up to the foreman, and none of the girls heard nothing about it. So it was just all a mysterious thing to them. That is too. Sure is.
Amen.
But this girl, just in the face of all of it, upon the basis of his word,
amen,
that he'd be back far. So they got to laugh, and they put their hands around one, dancing around her, and said, laughing, you know, like that. Said, "Poor little silly kid, she just stood there, not a bit of blush. She's holding her flowers, her wedding garment all fixed. She's struggling, you know. His bride has made herself ready."
Amen.
She kept holding her flowers, waiting. They said, "Nah, I told you it was wrong. See, he ain't coming." Said, "I got 5 more minutes. Said, he'll be here." Oh, they just laughed, and just by time the old clock ticked up to 5 minutes, they heard the horses a galloping,
yeah,
the sand rolling under the wheels.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The old buckboard stopped. She jumped from between him and out the door, and he jumped out of the carriage, and she fell into his arms and said, "It's all over now." Left her little old cousin denomination sitting there looking. She went to Chicago to a home. I know of another great promise like that too. "I've gone to prepare a place for you, coming back to receive you." They might be saying we're crazy, but brother, to me, right now, in these seals breaking like this, under this supernatural thing, I can almost hear the sound as that clock of time ticks away into eternity there. I can almost see that angel standing there and saying, "At the last, that seventh angel's message, time shall be no more." That little loyal bride will fly away into the arms of Jesus one of these days to be taken to the Father's house. Let's think of these things as we go along now.